It's a joint work with Roger, and what's the goal? We're trying to extend Kreps and Wilson's definition of sequential equilibrium from finite games to games with infinite actions, infinite types. Types for us just means information sets, so infinitely many information sets. And you know, extending definitions is easy. Doing it in a way that that produces good results. So we'll talk about what good means, and where one can prove a reasonably general existence theorem. That's a little harder. And you know, we've made a lot of progress, enough to talk about it, enough even to write a paper. But one might argue, and I would argue, that we haven't quite achieved the goal. And you'll see that we allow this. So we you know, define a solution, but I think we allow too many equilibria. Okay. So anyway, we'll get to all of that. One thing we'll do, and you know, one of the reasons this project, we've been working on this on and off for 7-8 years, something like that. And every time we thought, yeah, finally we've nailed it, here we go, well, then we'd come up with an example that just, we could see that, boy, what a terrible solution we've actually come up with here. So then we'd back to the drawing board a little bit, and then more examples. So we'll give you some examples that indicate where the remaining problems lie, and that'll give you some idea of you know, where you want to look if you want to help us push this theory ahead. So I'm going to start with some examples. I'm sorry. So let me define the environment. So it'll be dynamic multi-stage games. So what are they? The players move simultaneously. We'll suppose they're just finitely many dates. That's not that important. And what happens at date k? At the beginning of date k, nature first chooses a state, theta k, according to some probability distribution. And in general, that probability distribution over states at date k can depend on nature's previous choices, so states theta at dates less than k, and all the actions that the players chose, so the action profiles of the players at each date less than k. So nature's distribution can be history dependent fully. And then after nature makes her choice at the beginning of date k, players choose simultaneously, and each player I makes a choice from his action set A, I, K at date K. And you know, there's going to be some technicalities that I don't want to dwell on today. We're going to need some measurability structure and all of that so that expected payoffs are well defined. So we have some sigma algebras here on these objects. But what's an outcome of the game? So theta will theta is just capital theta is the set of sequences of nature's choices at each of the dates. Capital A is the sequence of profiles of date k action choices of all of the players. So an outcome of the game is a choice by nature at all the dates and a choice by the players at all the dates. So capital theta cross A is the set of outcomes of the game. We're going to index information by something we call a type. So a player's type at player I's type at date k will just be another way of saying, well, it's an information set, indexing the player's information set. So capital TIK is the set of player I's types at date k, and the product of all of those is capital T. And this is the only set that we're going to endow with a topology. So each of the type spaces of each player at each date is going to be endowed with a topology with a countable basis. And to really say what a player's information is, what do you know about the history of play, we have for each player I, each date k, there's a type function that maps the history. So at date k, what's happened when it's your turn to move? Well, nature's made her choice at the beginning of date k and previously, so there's a state theta less or equal to k that's been determined. But all of you players haven't yet chosen. You choose simultaneously. So the choices of the players that have been made at dates less than k. So there's a theta less or equal to k that's been determined already, and actions at dates less than k. So you find something out about that history, and that's described by this type function. It maps that history of play at date k into a type for you. So when you find out your type, if you invert that function, if you say, what are all of the histories of play that could have led to that type, that's your information set, the set of histories that you can't distinguish between at that point. Okay, so your type space and this function tau together determine your information, the information that you have at each day, that date. Okay? It's perfectly, it's completely general. No information, for example, would correspond to your type function being constant. Okay, so then you know nothing about the history of play. Perfect information, you can think of your type as simply being the vector of actions that the players chose and the vector of states that nature chose. Okay, so anything in between is also possible.
Yeah. Why did nature randomize it every date rather than just at the beginning?
So, good question, and the answer is that it allows us to prove our theorem. So if we understood, we'll show you what the theorem is, and the way that the notation in the theorem is developed is just we have a lot of independence thrown in there, and it turns out I don't know how to write it down. If we suppose that nature chose just once at the beginning, so one way to model this, a very standard idea, say, look, nature makes one choice at the beginning, and then you reveal pieces of that, and the tau functions would reveal those pieces, and that could be history. In some sense, that should be enough. But it turns out I don't know how to map that structure into the sort of assumptions that we need to prove the theorem we want to prove at the end. But I can do it we can do it this way. What's a strategy? So that's a multi-stage game. We'll talk about strategies for the player. So strategy is what you think it must be. So we'll talk about a strategy for player I at date k. It's a measurable function mapping your type into a probability distribution over actions. And a strategy for a player I in the whole game is just a vector of strategies for each of the dates k. Right? And then a profile of strategies is just a collective vector of those, one for each player. So that's it. So we now have the game, we have strategies, and given the measurability that we have that I haven't really quite described for you, strategies determine well-defined expected payoffs for the player. So we have a well-defined game here. But let's go to some examples. Okay, so the first example, it's a very simple game, but it yields... It's problematic nonetheless. So all the games that I'm going to describe are really simple, but darn it, they just have these nagging problems associated with them due to the infinities that are hanging around. So what's this? The first game? Two dates, and date one and four players. So two dates, four players. Date one, players one and two choose simultaneously. Player one chooses a number between minus one and one. And player two chooses either left or right. Okay, so player one is choosing among infinitely many actions, real number between minus one, any real number between minus one and one, and player two is choosing either left or right. They choose simultaneously at date one. Okay, date two, players three and four, they observe the actions chosen by players one and two, and then they have to make choices themselves, and each chooses either left or right simultaneously. Okay, that's it. There are payoffs, which I'll describe in a second, but that's it. So there's no nature. It's just two stages. Players one and two choose simultaneously in the first stage. Their actions are revealed to players three and four in the second, and players three and four choose simultaneously in the second stage. Players two, three, and four, they each choose either left or right. There's only one player who has infinitely many actions, and it's player one who's choosing a number between minus one and plus one. Okay, and of course there are infinitely many information sets for players three and four because they observe the action of player one in particular, but also player two. Okay, before they move. Okay, so what are the payoffs? Let's start with players 3 and 4. Payoffs are the simplest. Players 3 and 4, let me say in words what's here. What they want to do is they want to match, in some sense, the sign of player 1's action. So player 1 is choosing a number between minus 1 and 1, so he can choose either a negative number or a positive number, also 0, of course. And what players 3 and 4 are choosing either left or right. And this payoff, the payoff functions are set up so that if player 1 chooses a negative number, each of them individually strictly wants to choose left. If player 1 chooses a positive number, each of players 3 and 4 individually, no matter what the other person does, they each want to strictly choose right. Okay, and if player 1 chooses 0, they're indifferent between left and right. So let's just convince ourselves that's really what's going on here. So for example, if player 1 chooses, say, minus a half, then if player 3 chooses left, he'll get plus a half, because minus minus a half is plus a half. If he chooses right, he'll get minus a half. So if player, and that's true for any negative number that player 1 were to choose. Okay? So if player 1 chooses negative number to the left of 0, player 3 and 4 each individually want to choose left. Okay. So their decision problem's pretty simple. What about player 2? Player 2's payoff, well, she wants to match player 2. She's playing in date 1, player 2. Players 1 and 2 are playing at date 1. She wants to match the eventual choice of player 3. So player 2 is choosing either left or right, and player 3 at date 2 will either also be choosing either left or right. Player 2 would like her choice to match the eventual choice of player 3. Okay. Now, what she gets when she matches depends on whether she, player 2, played left or right. Okay. So the way I like to try and remember things, even though these are von Neumann-Morgenstern utilities, so I like to think of her choice of left as being less risky. Your choice of right as being risky. Okay, so what does it mean? That's just a mnemonic for my remembering. So if player 2 chooses left, remember she wants to match player 3. It's the less, it's her left choice, so it's left. It's less risky. So she'll get 1 if she matches player 3, minus 1 if she doesn't. If she chooses right, it's a little risky for her, then she'll get 2 if player 3 chooses right, if she matches player 3, and minus 2 otherwise. Okay, so that's how I remember the payoffs there. So, so player 2 wants to match 3's choice, her payoffs when matching and mismatching depends on whether she chooses left or right. Okay. What about player 1's payoff? Player 1's payoff is the sum of 3 terms. The first term, well, the largest, the thing that player 1 cares about most, is that players 3 and 4 match one another. If players 3 and 4 match one another, if they both choose left, or if they both choose right, then player 1 gets a bonus. He gets 10. Okay? So if players 3 and 4 match one another, player 1 gets 10. Secondly, plus, so we'll add to that, player 1 would like that players 2 and 3 mismatch. Remember, player 2 would like to match player 3. Player 1 gets a little bonus if they mismatch. And what sort of bonus does he get? He gets plus the absolute value of his action if players 2 and 3 mismatch. And if they match, he loses the absolute value of his action. Okay, so if he chooses a non-zero action, he really would like them to mismatch rather than match. Okay, so that'll be added to his payoff, whatever happens to it. And lastly, we subtract from his payoff the absolute value of his action. So he wants to, all else equal, he'd like to choose a small action rather than a larger one. Okay? Now notice that the payoffs here are, I mean, there's only one variable that's not discrete, and that's player 1's choice A1. And the payoffs, are continuous in the actions of player 1. Okay, so the down here also, we're just adding these terms. So if you think of the utility functions as functions of the four actions of the players. These are continuous functions. Okay, so we have it's a very nice game. We have compact, most of the strategy, the action sets are finite. Player one's is nice and compact. Payoff functions are continuous. What could be simpler? I mean, it just, you know, let's just, of course, subgame perfection. We don't even need to talk about sequential equilibrium here. To the extent that there's information and sequential rationality that has to be imposed, these are perfect information sets, singletons. So subgame perfection is really it. Okay? The problem is this game has no subgame perfect equilibrium. Okay, and it was kind of a shock. I mean, this was done some years ago, but so let's see if we can convince ourselves that that's true, how to convince ourselves. Well, let's argue by contradictions. Let's suppose there is subgame perfect equilibrium, and then argue to a contradiction. So, suppose there is a subgame perfect equilibrium. Claim one, player two, who would like her choice to match the eventual choice of player three, that claim is that player two actually must be mixing 50-50 left-right. Okay? So if there's a subgame perfect equilibrium, player two must be matching 50-50. So why is that? Well, suppose not. So suppose player two is putting more weight, say, on left than on right. Okay, so player two is putting more weight on left than on right. Okay, so now let's look at player one's reaction to that. Remember, player one would like two and three to mismatch. Possibly, it gets a little bonus. So let's look at player one's reaction to player two putting more weight on left than on right. So player one, look, he definitely wants three and four to match one another. And he can do that by simply either playing any number that's positive or any number that's negative. Yes, because players three and four individually are going to match. If player one chooses a number to the left of zero, they'll both play left. Chooses a number, to the left of zero, they'll both play left. To the right of zero, they'll both play right. So he can definitely get them to match, no problem, just by choosing a non-zero action. Okay, so he. He's going to get the 10, and now he's going to think about, I can get a bonus here. If player one is choosing, player two is putting more than probability half on left, then actually player one would do better if he can get player three to choose right, because he's going to get plus this with probability bigger than half and minus this with probably less than half. So he's going to have a positive expected payoff out of this. He can get player three to choose right. And he can do that by taking a positive action. So player one thinks about, if I take a positive action, I'm going to get a positive payoff here, and it's going to be linear in my action. Now I'm losing, but I'm losing as a quadratic. Square of my action. So there's going to be some strictly positive action that's uniquely optimal for player one there. And that's it. There's a unique, strictly positive action that maximizes player one's expected utility. He gets the 10 because both players one and three and four will choose right. And he's getting a positive payoff out of the combination of the linearity here and the quadratic loss here. Okay. Now, so he's choosing a strictly positive action with probability one. Player two is putting more weight on left than on right. What's going on? Player two in equilibrium knows what player one is doing, choosing a positive action with probability one, which means that player two knows that player three is going to choose right, not left. So player two shouldn't be putting more than probability half on left than on right. Okay. So it can't be that player two is putting more than probability a half on left than right, and similarly can't be putting more than probability a half on right than on left. So player two indeed must be mixing 50-50 on right left if there's a subgame perfect equilibrium. Okay, so that's step one. Okay, so if there's a subgame perfect equilibrium, player two is mixing 50-50. Again, now let's think about what player one must be doing. So again, go back here. Player one can certainly get the 10 by choosing either a positive or negative action. Let's look at the middle term here. Notice that if player one chooses a positive action, he knows that player three is going to choose right. But player two is mixing 50-50, so he doesn't know whether players two and three will match or mismatch. They're equally likely to match or mismatch. So this is going to be a wash if he chooses a positive action. It's also a wash if he chooses a negative action, because then three is going to choose left for sure. But again, two is mixing 50-50, so maybe they'll mismatch or mismatch. And if he chooses an action zero, well, he's getting zero no matter what player three does. So no matter what player one does, this is a wash. He's getting zero here because player two is mixing 50-50. So forget the middle term. The only terms are the 10 and the minus a1 squared. Player one can certainly get the 10 because he can take a small positive action, any positive action, get players three and four to coordinate. So he's going to get the 10. But any action gets him, so he can get 10 minus a1 squared for any non-zero a1. So he can get arbitrarily close to 10, player one can get arbitrarily close to 10. And he certainly can't do better than 10. So if it's an equilibrium, he must be getting exactly 10. So it's got to be that he's playing a1 equals 0 and he's getting 10. Okay? And that player 2 is mixing 50-50. So where are we? We've determined that player 1 must be choosing 0, so the action 0. Player 2, so here's player 1, here's game starts, there's player 1. Player 2 must be choosing 50-50 on left-right. Okay, and then players three and four, well, they're choosing simultaneously. And player one must be getting a payoff of 10. All right, that's what we know so far. Player one is choosing action zero, player two is mixing 50-50, and player one's payoff must be exactly 10. So it has to be that players three and four here are coordinating here either on left-left, because player one has to get his 10, exactly, for sure, probability one. So these guys have to be coordinating either here left-left, here right-right, or here left-left, or right-right, okay? Now let me put in these cells, I could put all of the payoffs here, it's the end of the game. In these cells, let me put actually player two's payoffs. Okay, so let me put in these cells. These are player three and four's actions. But let me put player two's payoffs here. So remember how we player two. If player two chooses left, this is less risky. Player two wants to match player three, who's choosing the row. So if player two matches, uses the less risky strategy, player two gets a payoff of one. So one, one. If player three chooses right so that players two and three mismatch, player two gets a payoff of minus one. Okay? If player two chooses right, that's the riskier strategy, and matches with player three, she gets two, and otherwise minus two if player three instead chooses left. Okay, so those are the payoffs to player two. Now we've said that it has to be that we can select, you know, what equilibrium is played here, but it has to be that either left-left is being chosen here or right-right is being chosen. So we have to choose either this cell or this one, one or the other. And here, left-left or right-right is being chosen because, again, players three and four have to match in order for player one to get his payoff of 10. But notice that none of these four numbers here that are possible are equal to one another. Yeah, they're all distinct. So no matter what selection we make here and here, player two is not indifferent. So two would not be willing to mix. Okay, so that's it. No, there's no, that's the final contradiction. So there's no subgame perfect equilibrium here. However, for any epsilon, there's an epsilon subgame perfect equilibrium. There are lots of them, there are lots of ways to, but for example, player one can choose, instead of going right to zero, player one can choose plus or minus epsilon, 50-50 each. player two chooses left, right, 50-50 each, and players three and four, player one chooses an action less than or equal to zero, they both coordinate on left, and if he chooses an action that's positive, they both coordinate on right. That's in fact, every player is optimizing exactly, except player one, who's not exactly optimizing, but is epsilon optimizing, getting a payoff of 10 minus epsilon squared, and that's in fact epsilon squared optimizing even. Okay, and so you kind of see what's happening. You might be tempted to take the limit as epsilon goes to zero of this epsilon equilibrium, and you see what's happening here is that in this epsilon equilibrium, players three and four have something to coordinate on. Yes, they're getting a signal. They're looking at player one's action, and they're coordinating based on player one's action, whether it's positive, whether it's negative. In the limit, take this sequence of this mixed strategy. If you think about this, say, the weak star limit distribution, then of course, so player one is choosing plus or minus epsilon. The limit distribution, that signal disappears. With probability one, player one is taking action zero. And if you actually look at the limit distribution over the outcomes, the limit distribution is that with probability one, player one is choosing zero. Player two is choosing left, right. Players three and four are also choosing left and right with probability half, but actually perfect in a perfectly correlated way. So the weak star limit distribution over outcomes is one where when player two chooses left here, players three and four are correlating. Left, left, right, right, probability 50-50 each. And here also left, left, right, right, probability 50-50 each. And so there's a well-defined limit distribution, but there are no strategies, of course, independent strategies for the players that deliver that distribution. Okay, so and the problem that's happening formally is that the set of strategies that induce the limit distribution, it's not closed. Okay. But for us, so you might ask, well, one thing you could say is, well, there's no subgame perfect equilibrium. Let's just pack up shop and go home. But we're not going to do that. We're going to take this essentially as the solution. That is, the limit distribution here, we're going to say, roughly, is this the solution to the game. So this, the first thing to observe here is that this existence problem forces us, or at least we made the choice, to say what we're going to do is we're not going to describe the solution to the game in terms of strategies, because there are no strategies that deliver this outcome. We're going to describe the solution to the game in terms of probability distributions over outcomes. It'll be more than that even, but we'll get there. Okay, but that's the idea. And what are those probability distributions? Well, they're those that are limits in this example of sequences of epsilon subgame perfect equilibria, but of course we're aiming for sequential equilibria. So we have to define something like an epsilon sequential equilibrium of these infinite games and take limits of those. That's where we're headed. All of the ways that we tried and thought about discretizing the games, you know, giving them finite strategies in some way, eventually we found examples that said that's just a crazy idea. I'm going to give you one of those examples in which just the naive approximation of taking the action, there's only one action set that's infinite again in the second example, discretizing it is just, it's a disaster, okay? It's just the wrong thing to do. It's clearly the wrong thing to do. Okay, so what's this game? So in this game, nature makes an appearance. So nature chooses a number, either the number one or the number two. And the probability of the number one is one-third, the probability of the number two is two-thirds. Okay. Player one gets no information, but has to choose a number, a real number between zero and one. Player two moves next at date two, and she gets some information. What information does she get? Well, she is told whatever one's action is, it's raised to the power theta. She's told that number. So for example, if one chooses the number a half, and nature happened to be one, then player two would hear the number half. If nature was instead two, then player two would hear the number a quarter. Now suppose you're player two, yes, and if you hear one quarter, there's your one quarter, well, you're confused about what happened. Yes, you're not sure. There are two ways that you could have heard that one quarter would be your type. Either player one chose a quarter and nature and theta was one, or player one chose a half and nature was two. Okay, so you can't distinguish between those, and that's okay. And in any case, you're given some information, player two, and you have to make a choice, either one or two. Okay. What are the payoffs here? Here they are. And the payoffs, notice, they depend only on nature's choice of one or two and player two's choice of one or two. The payoffs don't depend on player one's choice at all. So this number that player one chooses between 0 and 1 has no effect directly on the payoffs. Let's start with player two's incentives here. What are her payoffs? Notice player two would like to match the state. Notice the state is either 1 or 2, and player two chooses a number either 1 or 2. And the payoffs here are such that player two would like to match the state. Indeed, when the state is 1, player two would like to choose 1. She gets a payoff of 1 if she does. She gets a payoff of 0 if she mismatches the state. If the state is 2, she gets 0 if she chooses 1, and 1 if she chooses it matches the state at 2. Okay, so player two wants to match the state if she can. What about player one? Player one, well, you know, he just wants player two to choose action 1. If she chooses action 1, he gets a payoff of 1 no matter what the state. If she chooses action 2, he gets a payoff of 0 no matter what the state. So player 1 just wants to, you know, just wants to do something to convince player 2 that the state is 1. Yeah, I want you to play 1. Play 1 for me, will you? And that's it doesn't matter what the state is, he wants you to play 1. Now player 1 doesn't even know the state himself. Yes, he gets no information, he takes an action, but nonetheless, it could be that his action. So, if player one, say, always were to play a half, then that would reveal the state, yes, to player. Because if it were known, common knowledge, or known that player two knew that player one was always choosing a half, then if she sees a half, she knows the state is 1. If she sees a quarter, she knows the state is 2. So, even though player one doesn't know the state, there are strategies for player one that would reveal the state for player to player two. But of course that wouldn't be an equilibrium because let's in that example what's happened. That's a good example. So let's suppose that player one chooses action one. Could that be an equilibrium? Okay. Okay, player one chooses action a half. Then with probability 1/3, the state is 1. Player two is going to observe a half and know that the state is 1, so she'll play 1. With probability 2/3, the state is 2. Player two will observe a quarter. The half will be raised to the power 2. Player two will then know the state is 2, and she'll play action 2, and player one will get a payoff of 0. Now you're player one, you know this. You say to yourself, if I actually choose the equilibrium strategy of a half, then with probability 1/3, I'm going to get a payoff of 1. With probability 2/3, I get a payoff of 0. Ah, I can do better. Suppose I instead choose a quarter. If I choose a quarter, if I deviate to a quarter, then with probability, did I do this right? No, sorry, 1 over root 2, excuse me, okay? 1 over the square root of 2, if I deviate to the 1 over the square root of 2, then with probability 2/3, nature will square it, produce the signal a half, and that's the signal that will get player two to choose 1. So I'll get my payoff of 1 with probability 2/3 rather than 1/3. Okay? So that wouldn't be an equilibrium for player one just to choose a half for sure. And in fact, it's not hard to show that there's no strategy for player one that can get player two ever to play action one. Notice, by the way, I didn't say it, and I should have, it's important. If player two gets no information from the strategy of the choice of player one, then you know, the prior is that 1/3 on theta equals 1 and 2/3 on theta equals 2. So player two is going to take action two. She gets an expected payoff of 2/3 rather than 1/3. So that's important. Yes, with no information, player two is going to take the wrong action from player one's point of view. But there just isn't anything player one can do. And again, it's not that hard to show in equilibrium to credibly convince player two that the state is won, because player one will always manipulate and take advantage of that. Okay, again, not hard to show. So, and that's in any Nash equilibrium. Yes? We're trying to define sequential equilibrium. It better at least be Nash. And here, in any Nash equilibrium, player one's payoff is zero. Okay. So, for example, one Nash equilibrium is that player one, you know, just chooses the number zero. If you choose the number zero, then the signal is one no matter what. That conveys no information. And player two chooses action two. And in fact, player two's strategy would be, I'll choose action two no matter what. So choosing zero is optimal for one. He can't do anything about it. So it's an Nash equilibrium. OK, fine. So that's in this game, this player one's payoff. So if we were to define sequential equilibrium in any sensible way, it better be that player one's payoff is zero. Or if we were thinking of epsilon Nash or epsilon sequential, as I said, we eventually will, it should be close to zero. But now let's take a naive finite approximation. So let's the only infinite object here is player one's action space. Let's discretize that space and discretize it by more than just putting zero and one in there. Let's eventually we want to put lots of things in there. So choose a finite subset that includes not just zero and one. The claim is that then in any, and again, we're trying to define sequential equilibrium, so it had better at least be subgame perfect. But in any subgame perfect equilibrium of this now finite game, I claim that player one's payoff is at least 1/3. It's bounded away from zero. No matter how fine this finite approximation is. So why is that? Well, think of the highest number. Think of the highest number that's strictly less than 1. Okay, so 0 is here, 1 is here. So think of the highest number in this finite set that's strictly less than 1. Say it's 0.9. Okay? Now suppose that you're player 2. I'm player 1. Suppose I play 0.9. I'm just thinking, what would happen if I played 0.9? I say, well, with probability 1/3, nature raises that to the power 1, state is 1, and you see 0.9. So now you're player two. You see 0.9 and you ask yourself, how could it be that I saw 0.9? Well, it can't be that the state is 2, because that would square. Is it, 1 is in, maybe 1 is part of my action, but if I chose action 1, then you'd have seen 1. The only way you can see 0.9, if 0.9 is the highest number less than 1, is if the state is 1, is if I chose 0.9 and the state is 1. So in fact, that history is one where your information, it's perfect information. When you see 0.9, you know that I chose 0.9 and that nature chose 1. You have perfect information there. So subgame perfection says you must optimize. Yes, so this is a perfect information set. And when the state is 1, if you're optimizing, you must be choosing 1. So I know as player 1, no matter what, that if I choose 0.9, then with probability 1/3, you'll see 0.9 and play 1. So I have to get, in any subgame perfect equilibrium, an expected payoff of at least 1/3, because I can always choose 0.9 if I wish. Okay, and that's no matter how you discretize this game, how you approximate it. So and that's just wrong, yes? That's a terrible approximation to this game. Now you could think of other ways of trying to discretize the game. As I said, you can also think about finite partitions of the player's type spaces. That's basically restricting players to, say, step functions, and that gives them finitely many strategies. You can think of restricting strategy spaces themselves to finite sets. But then there are other examples. It just complications just add up, and it just gets unwieldy. And we could never do it. It just never. So we stopped. We stopped trying to approximate the game. And we moved to, you've just got to include all of the strategies and think about epsilon equilibrium ideas. Now that's, you know, it was 4 or 5 years before we got there, and we resisted it a lot, because that now makes existence harder. If you discretize the infinite game with a finite game, now you could piggyback on Kreps Wilson and say, we know what sequential equilibria are in finite games. Let's just take limits of those. Existence is trivial if we could approximate infinite games with finite games in a good way. If you can figure out how to do it, that would be great. That would be great. We've moved on. Okay, we've really tried, and we couldn't do it. Next example, consistency beliefs. Yeah, that's a key property of sequential equilibrium. And what's the basic logic there? You're testing. You have strategy profile. You also have a system of beliefs. We're now in finite games. You have beliefs at each information set about the probability distribution. Over the histories you can't distinguish between. And how do you check that your beliefs are consistent? The way you check that they're consistent, given the strategy program and the beliefs, is that, of course, the information sets that occur with positive probability according to the strategy, the consistency is easy to check. You just look at whether the beliefs are the Bayes rule-induced beliefs. No problem. Problem is that the information sets that are reached with probability zero, given the strategy profile. Are the beliefs there consistent? Well, one has to perturb the strategy profile a little bit so that that information set has positive probability. Now you can look at the Bayes rule-induced beliefs. And then you take the limit of those Bayes rule-induced beliefs. And if they converge to the beliefs that you started with, then those beliefs are consistent. Okay, that's how you check. So you check by perturbing the strategies and seeing if those perturbed strategies give you Bayes rule-induced beliefs that are close, arbitrarily close to the beliefs that you specified there. Okay, so now we want to think about we want to take that. Of course, you want to take that and apply it to the infinite case if you can. You want to think about. And of course, you can't, if you have a continuum of information sets, you can't give everything simultaneously positive probability. Of course not. What you might think of doing is, doing it for any finite number of information sets at a time. You give me a finite number of information sets, I'm going to perturb so that everything has positive probability. I have beliefs everywhere, and I want to check whether those beliefs everywhere are consistent with one another. A sensible way of doing it is to take any finite collection of those information sets, perturb the strategies, and see if the beliefs you have there are close to the Bayes rule-induced ones. That would be a natural thing to do. But only if it worked. Yes, and goodness gracious, even that that's a problem, it turns out. And after example two, of course, comes example four. There's an example three in the paper that I've skipped over here. So what's this example? There are, again, two dates. Nature starts by choosing a uniform 0-1 random variable theta. And player one, with no information about nature's choice, chooses an action that has two coordinates. The first coordinate is discrete, so delta. Delta is discrete, either left or right. The second coordinate is also 0-1, so it's eta. It sounds like theta. So theta and eta are both between 0 and 1. Okay, so player two chooses left, right, and also chooses a number between 0 and 1. Then player two observes a number. She finds out a number. So she's going to observe either, she observes either nature's choice of theta, she observes player one's choice of eta. Both of those are numbers between 0 and 1. She's going to observe one of them or the other of them. When does she observe nature? She observes nature's number if player 1 chose left, and she'll observe player 1's number if player 1 chose right. Okay? And then she has to choose either left or right. Okay, it sounds complicated. But what's going to go on here? This is really it's going to be a battle of the sexes game between players 1 and 2. So each of them are choosing left and right, and one of them is the favorite coordinated choice for one of them, and the coordinated other choice is the favorite for the other. So 2-1 and 1-2. I'll write down the payoffs in a second. But there's a twist. The twist is that player two, before making her choice, so player one is There's two twists. Player one is not only choosing left and right to coordinate on the battle of the sexes, but also player one is choosing a number. Player two, before she makes her choice, she's going to observe this number. And it's going to be a payoff irrelevant number, but it's either the number chosen by player one or player two. Okay, so that's we just have the battle of the sexes payoff. They depend only on the left-right choices. And left-left is player two's favorite, and right-right is player one's favorite. Okay? So again, what's going on? Nature chooses a number uniformly between 0 and 1. Player 1 has to choose left, right, but also a number between 0 and 1. If player 1 chooses left, then player 2, you're going to observe a number. Which number do you observe? Depends on what player 1 does, his choice. If player 1 chooses left, you observe nature's number. If player 1 chooses right, you observe 1's number. And then you have to make a choice. And this left or right, a coordinated choice. And this number that's chosen, either by nature or by me, I'll be player one, is payoff irrelevant. Okay? Fine. So we claim, this is subjective, yes, but our claim is that, you know, all of the battle of the sexes equilibria that we're accustomed to here, there are three, there's the left-left, right-right, and the mixture, a third, two-thirds, depending on, you know, higher probability on your favorite, seem reasonable to us as sequential equilibrium. Well, we haven't defined sequential equilibrium. What are we talking about? But how would we think of it? So, for example, suppose, let me just give you strategies that seem to us reasonable. Player one is going to choose uniformly, just like nature, okay? And player two is just going to ignore the number. You know you're going to observe a number. It's going to be uniform, you know, it comes from a uniform distribution, whether it was chosen by player one or by player two. And, you know, you're just going to ignore it. I mean, it gives you no information. Yes, okay? And so whatever, now patch on to that any of the battle of the sexes equilibria, either left-left, right-right, or the mixture. Okay? We claim that's nice subgame, you know, that we should think of that as a nice sequential equilibrium here. No matter what you observe player two, you expect to observe a number. It's uniform 0, 1, that's with its distribution no matter what. It conveys no information about what player 1 did, and that's the end of that. Okay. But now, suppose we want to apply this checking consistency of beliefs. Player 2, you know, you have lots of information sets. You're observing a number. Each number between 0 and 1 is an information set for you. Okay? So now suppose... Good, you're player two, and suppose that, I don't know, you observe pi over four. Okay, so there you are, pi over four came, it's a number. And now we're checking consistency of your beliefs. You have to have some beliefs about the history of play. What is it that you don't know? You know that the number pi over four was, but you don't know whether it was because I chose right and chose pi over 4, and that's you observed my pi over 4, or it's because I chose left and you're observing nature's pi over 4. You don't know which is which. So we perturb the strategies, yes? Let's do the Kreps-Wilson idea. Let's perturb the strategies so that this information set for you, by the way, of course, has probability 0 in my purported equilibrium of both of us choosing uniform 0, 1. Pi over 4 has probability 0. But let's perturb the strategies to give it positive probability. Well, how can we perturb the strategies to give it positive probability? The only way to do it is to perturb my strategy player 1 so that I choose right and I put positive probability on pi over 4. That will mean that you will observe pi over 4. That's the only way you can observe pi over 4 with positive probability. If I choose right, so it's my number you're going to observe, and the number that I chose was pi over 4. Okay, so let me just finish the point. Yes? The only way to give it the positive probability. So we make the perturbation. What are your Bayes' rule-induced beliefs? Your Bayes' rule-induced beliefs under that perturbation are that I chose the number and that I chose right. So you must believe now with probability 1 that I chose right. But then you're going to choose right because you want to coordinate. But when you choose right and I choose right, I get my favorite payoff of 2. So I know now that if I choose the number pi, if I choose right and I choose pi over 4, you're going to choose right. It's the best equilibrium for me. The only equilibrium, therefore, if we do this exercise, is one where we both choose right. Okay. I'm glad that furrowed brow, frowns, I agree with all of you. It's just terrible, right? This is terrible.
So one thing that I'm finding kind of confusing about the argument here is that, contrary to the way it's often described, Bayes' rule doesn't have a problem with zero probability events. Bayes' rule has a problem with events outside of the support. I mean, there's no problem if I have a normal prior and observe a signal that's normally distributed. I have no problem updating, even though the signal realization I saw had a zero probability event. It seems like the real Bayes' rule gets in trouble when I see things that are outside of the support that I expected. So in this world where I'm uniform and the nature is uniform, I don't see why you need to perturb anything.
Bayes' rule gives you, what it formally gives you is that, you know, almost everywhere your beliefs are well defined.
Okay. But it seems like here, I guess in this example.
Of course we want to say there should be no problem here. The question is how to formally set it up, not only here, but elsewhere, so that when you do, we want to say things like, what are the events that have positive probability or zero probability that matter? You can't formally say that you've defined beliefs at every single theta. Even though I know, Amir, you want to do that. You can't. Bayes' rule doesn't do it for you. It doesn't, I'm sorry. What it does, what probability theory does for you, it tells you that for almost every theta, your beliefs are well defined. But that leaves, and it doesn't say which are the ones that are in and which are the ones are out.
I'm just confused.
That's okay. That's all right. We can go. That's what probability theory does for you. It doesn't. There's no Bayes' rule that gives you in standard probability theory conditional probabilities. It will give you for almost in the equilibrium that I described. It'll say for almost all theta what your beliefs should be for those theta. Almost all. Doesn't say what your belief should be for all theta. Yeah, I mean, it just doesn't.
I got to change the way I teach Bayes' rule to undergrads then, because
no,
I have
I'm
no
not sure. No, I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't. I'm not. No.
So then
no.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. I'll guess. I'll just.
Okay. So. But we all agree this is kind of crazy, right? There's something crazy about this, and a natural thing to do. To try to get out of this, in this example, I think a natural thing to think about is, well, you should perturb nature also. Okay, so I mean, what's going on here is that the whole problem, you know, even in finite games, the consistency condition is allowing you to think about different orders of magnitudes of zero probabilities. Epsilons, epsilon squareds, epsilon cubes, they're all going to zero, but the epsilon squared is infinitely less likely than an epsilon, etc. Okay, and that's important. And here what's going on is that, you know, yes, it's true that nature's zero is in some sense a real zero. I mean, there it is, nature, you can't, if we're not perturbing nature, it's a zero. But you as player two, you should be able to think about things like, in fact, so let's think about the supporting the equilibrium left-left. Remember, the one we're getting here when I do the perturbation is right-right. So let's try supporting the left-left, the one that's better for you, and where I'm just choosing uniform 0-1 just like nature. I'm player one still. Okay? If you observe this pi over 4, you should be able to say, look, I know it has... Phil chose left, so I'm supposed to be observing nature's number. It's pi over 4. That's probability zero event. And you have to ask yourself, is it more likely that Phil chose right and pi over 4 than that Phil that Phil deviated and chose right and chose pi over 4 as opposed to Phil choosing equilibrium left and nature choosing pi over 4? Those are two things that had zero probability ex ante. But you should be able to weight those, and you know, which one is the more likely zero probability event, which is the less likely zero. The perturbation that I'm giving you forces you to believe that the less likely event is the one where nature chooses her zero. But that's only because we're not allowed to perturb nature. If I let you perturb nature to say, you know, it's more likely that Phil chose the equilibrium left and that nature chose, let's put a little small positive probability, nature choosing pi over 4, and let's make that infinitely more likely than Phil having chosen left, deviating and choosing, I'm saying right, excuse me. Okay? So it's very natural reaction to this example to say, you know, we should allow perturbations also of nature. Kreps and Wilson don't. Okay, they don't perturb nature. Nature is finite and it's all positive probability, so perturbing wouldn't make any difference even if they did. But they don't perturb nature, but it's a suggestion might be here. You know, it's obvious we should perturb nature. I can come back to this example if we really need to, this next example shows, even though you might want to perturb nature, that's a natural reaction to the, and it would get you out of this problem. So in that example that we just showed, if I allow you to perturb nature, you can support all of the three types of equilibria, and it's just all fine. Okay, it would be fine. But there are other examples where you perturb nature, and you just know that's the wrong thing to do. Okay, and let me say that this example, which I'm not going to show you, it's a very sort of basic example where perturbing nature gives you crazy equilibria. It's easy to then make suggestions. Ah, but you allowed this sort of perturbation. If you just restricted the perturbations of nature a little bit, you'd get rid of that. True, we tried. So now you start restricting nature. Maybe you add metric spaces for nature even, so you have close-by perturbations you can talk about. Then the examples just get more complicated, and suddenly you have this, you know, the restrictions get more, and so you have this very complicated theory of restrictions of how to, you know, perturb nature, and even then we couldn't prove that now there are no more bad examples. So maybe there's a nice way of doing that. Maybe there is a nice way of perturbing nature, restricting the perturbations so that you just keep beautiful equilibria and not crazy ones. I don't know. Maybe that's the way to go, and we're not going that way, and we're therefore not making enough restrictions. That's why the extra equilibria we know we're allowing too many, and these are the problems this one in particular that we haven't been able to solve. Okay, let me go on. Tell you now what we do. What's the theory that the solution we're going to offer. Okay, so remember, type spaces have topologies. So we're going to talk about observable open events. So remember, an information set for you is described by a single type. We're going to look at subsets of your information sets, subsets of your types, open sets of types. And we're going to say an open set of types is observable if there's a strategy profile that open set of types for you has positive probability. Okay, so take the battle of the sexes game. The type for you of pi over 4, well, that's not an open set, but put a little open ball around it that has positive probability in the equilibrium that I described, where we're both choosing 0. Okay, so that's an observable event because there are strategies that give it positive probability. And for today's talk, let's just assume that all open sets of types can have positive probability. There are examples where it's not true, but that's not a detail that matters today. So we'll let T star be the disjoint union of all of the observable open sets. Okay, so for each player, you have your type space, you have your open sets, they're all observable. Let's just put them all together in one big set and call that T star. Okay, what's a neighborhood basis for the player's types? It's really just a neighborhood basis for a topology, but with one little exception. A neighborhood basis for the player's types, that's a subset B of this, the collection of all open sets. We're forcing it to include the type spaces of each agent at each date. Okay, but other than that, it's just a neighborhood basis. Meaning what? meaning that, for any type, for any open set containing it, there's an open set in the basis that is contained in this original open set C, and that contains the type. Okay, so that is to say, for any type, for any open set containing it, there's a subset of that open set that's open and also contains the type. There are arbitrarily small open sets containing any type. That's really what a neighborhood basis is. Okay, so now we want to define, as I said, the solution is going to be a limit idea. It's going to be the limit of epsilon. Remember, we talked about epsilon subgame perfect equilibria. That we understand how to define. But we don't know what an epsilon sequential equilibrium is in infinite games, so we have to define this object. And we want to check consistency somehow, but we can't check consistency at every all of the infinitely many information sets simultaneously. So we're going to do that for any finite subset of them, any finite subset of open observable events. We're going to check consistency there. Okay, and we're going to let the set of open observable events at which we check consistency grow as much as we like, and we're going to let epsilon shrink to zero. That's the kind of limit we're going to take. Okay, so epsilon here is an epsilon. F is going to be a finite set of open observable events. And of course we have to talk about continuation strategy. So for any strategy for a player, what is a continuation? A continuation strategy is the obvious thing. It agrees with the at date k. If it's a continuation at date k, it agrees with the original strategy at dates before k, and might differ at date k later. So that's a continuation strategy for date k continuation strategy. So what's an epsilon f sequential equilibrium? So you give me an epsilon positive. You give me any finite collection of these open sets of types. So for you, player one, we've got some finite set of types in the game for you, finite set of open sets of types for you. For you, player two, we also have a finite set of types, etc. For all of the players, finite sets of open sets of types. We're going to say that S is an epsilon F sequential equilibria. If for each player I, for each date, we look at that player I at that date, and we check all of the finitely many open sets in our collection that are in that player's open set of types for that date. We're asking that S, the strategy S, give those positive probability, and that conditional on that open set of each of those open sets of your types, player I, that S is epsilon optimal. That is, no continuation strategy gives more than an epsilon better payoff than S. Okay? So you're epsilon optimizing, and at each of these finitely many open sets of events for you, each of them has positive probability, and your epsilon optimizing conditional. And the conditional is well defined because they each have positive probability. Okay? So that's an epsilon F sequential equilibrium. So now we want to take limits. We want to take limits of what? What are we taking limits of? Remember, it's the strategies. I mean, there aren't going to be limit strategies. That's the first example. We're taking limits of distributions over outcomes, okay? But we're going to do more than just look at the limits of the equilibrium distribution of outcomes. We're actually going to look at, for any observable event for you, conditional on that, you can say, well, you know, what would happen after that observation? What's the distribution over the outcomes conditional on that event? So for any open observable event, we can ask, what's the conditional distribution induced by an epsilon F sequential equilibrium? And then we're going to do that for all. We're going to take the set of course, this F is going to expand to include all of the open sets. The epsilon is going to go to zero. And so we're going to ask in the limit, for any open set of events, for any player, what's the probability distribution over outcomes? That's the object that's going to be the solution to the game. It's going to describe, for any open set of events, essentially it's going to give a finitely additive probability measure over the space of outcomes. Okay? Dirk.
I was just wondering if you were to just restrict that operation to games without nature, that is just to subgame perfect equilibria. You get something.
Games, which you said two things. You first said games without nature, and then you said subgame perfect equilibria.
Yeah, so it's
We can talk about them separately if you want.
Games without nature.
So games without nature. I mean, one approach to writing a paper would be just to start with games without nature and say, you know, here's the games without nature pose no problem. In some sense. I mean, you know, the problem of the battle of the sexes game, it's only a problem because nature, darn it, was, you know, giving us these probability zero kind of continuum. Without nature, all of that goes away. And we could develop, I think, a, you know, pretty nice theory. So, but we chose not to do it because, you know, it's a real crux of the matter is with nature, and with such a serious lack of understanding that we have, we didn't want to give the impression that we really understood what we were doing and just do games without nature. I mean, there's a big gap there. So let me just give you the solution and then just talk. The definition. So again, it's a limit idea. But like any limit, you can kind of do epsilon deltas, and this is sort of the epsilon delta version, which is ugly in some ways, but you really see what's going on in others. So the solution is this object mu. Okay, what is mu doing? It's operating on the set of outcome events. So there's measurable outcomes. Measurable subsets of outcomes of the game, and elements of this neighborhood basis B. Okay, these are open, observable events, and let's just look here for a second. So given any open observable event C, so this is an element of B here. Okay, it'll be, and given any outcome event Y, this mu, this is a number. It's a number between 0 and 1. The interpretation of this number is this is the probability that the outcome is in the set Y conditional on a player observing this open observable event. Okay, conditional on this open observable event occurring. Okay, that's the interpretation. And this mu must give answers to all of those questions for any open observable event in this neighborhood basis script B. For any outcome event Y, mu must give an answer. What's the probability of Y given C? Okay. So that's the formal object that describes a solution. Okay, is the mu. Okay, so when we say that mu is an open sequential equilibrium, if what? Well, if beta is some neighborhood basis for the player's types, and for every epsilon, for any finite subset of these open observable events, and for any finite subset of outcome events, there is some epsilon f sequential equilibrium s such that what is true? Well, such that, look, this sequential equilibrium epsilon F sequential equilibrium, it gives answers to all of the questions for any outcome event Y that's in this finite set G, for any C that's in this finite set F, it gives an answer. What's the probability that Y occurs conditional on C? Because C has positive probability according to S, because S is an epsilon F sequential equilibrium. So it gives answers. And this is saying that mu has to be give a very similar answer, has to be within epsilon. Okay? And it must be true for every epsilon. Yes, so think about taking epsilon to 0, thinking about taking these sets F to expand them to include all open observable events, expand G to include all measurable outcome events. Then you're really saying that what this is really saying is that the limit of this probability as F and G expand to include all of the events there's a sequence, a net actually, of strategies such that the limit of this object, of this probability, is exactly mu. Okay, so it's doing what we did with the first example, taking limits, but it's a little more complicated. You know, there are nets involved here because we have a lot of sets to include, and what the limit operation in terms of the probability measure, it's not weak star. We don't have metric spaces or anything like that, even topologies on actions and states. But it's point-wise, it's set-wise convergence. And for that reason, the mu for any C the mu is a finitely additive probability measure on the outcome events. Need not be countably additive. Okay, one can add bells and whistles and compactness and all of that and get countable additivity, but this is the more fundamental. I'm out of time. I'll just say we give a theorem, an existence theorem, for a reasonably large class of games. The hard part is proving existence of epsilon F sequential equilibria. That's where the equilibrium idea lies. Once you have that for any epsilon and F, this existence of a mu really just follows from Tikhonov's theorem. But we can talk about that if anyone's interested. That's all we've got. Thank you.